Please invite the deputation to come to join us.
Welcome
to you all, deputations and individuals, and we have a representative from the administration here with us. This is the third session. I'd like to tell deputations and individuals that in front of you is an earpiece. If you would like to hear interpretation, you can use the earpiece. And channel zero is a floor. You may need to use it because you may need to hear what people say more clearly. Channel one is Cantonese, channel 2 is English, and channel 3 is Putonghua. There is simultaneous interpretation service. Please, you do not use cocktail language. And you'll find in front of you, I noticed the persons attending legal meetings. Each member, each deputation or individual will be given 3 minutes. We don't have enough time, so I will ask you to stop when your time is up. Also, please pay attention that what you say here orally and what you say in your written submission is not protected under the Legal Powers and Privileges Ordinance. Well, when you're ready, we will start. First, Ms. Low, Bo Xiulan. She's wheelchair-bound, so she can't really speak into the microphone. I apologize for that. If you're trying to get yourself ready, perhaps we'll listen to the next member first, Ms. Zhang. Thank you. I have heard from a lot of deputations in the past, in the previous two sessions. I'm not going to go through what they've already said. What I'd like to say is that, first of all, whether the report is prepared by a civic body or the consultant, there is a clear message. They support universal retirement protection. We can see from the different surveys and different opinion polls that is the same. However, regrettably, the government tries to keep means-tested support scheme. We find that very regrettable. And we have to say it very clearly here that we have never stopped the government in doing anything in poverty alleviation, but that is not universal retirement protection. If Carrie Lam, the government, or Matthew Cheung think that using a means-tested scheme will solve the problem, I think they have made a grave mistake and they just want the best of both worlds. Universal retirement protection is not a simple welfare issue for elderly people, and it's not a labor issue either. This is political as well because it involves allocation, how and how much. We've spent a lot of time, about 4 years, to waste a lot of time on making it financially viable. But this is not about financial viability. We have to tackle issues brought about by an aging population. If we don't talk about politics, you can't possibly resolve the issue. And in the upcoming policy address, CY Leung, the chief executive, will have to make good his promises. Even if he does not seek re-election, he has to deliver what he has already promised. That is a very clear voice or demand from the public. Well, the government proposes this 3,400 scheme. It's only an enhancement of the means-tested scheme. As we all know, that the government has put in place a different means-tested schemes to try to solve this problem. We have a serious poverty issues among elderly people. Over 30% of the people live in poverty. All these schemes cannot resolve the basic problem of elderly people not being able to make ends meet. So I want to make it very clear that the government will have to make good their words even when CY Leung does not seek re-election. They have to give us universal retirement protection. And anyone who wants to seek to run in the CE election, they have to make their stance very clear in relation to universal retirement protection. Now we go back to Ms. Low. You may start now. Good afternoon. I'm here to talk about this. In 1997, Tung Chee Hwa was the chief executive. He talked about aging in place and elderly people being useful. However, nothing was realized. And CY Leung talked about universal retirement protection. However, he said that it's not sustainable. It seems that he has already decided that it's going to be doomed before it starts. And CY Leung said that if he was elected as chief executive, he would do something real about universal retirement protection. However, he came up with a scheme that's that only gives us $2,200. It's a half-baked effort. He just wanted to fob us off, and he also introduced this means-tested scheme. He's making trouble out of nothing. Professor Nelson Chow has compiled a report about retirement protection. However, the government opposed to what Professor Nelson Chow said in relation to his support for universal retirement protection. And I think Mr. Matthew Cheung, he is a miser. Mrs. Carrie Lam is a miser. We don't have retirement protection at all. The government officials do not have people's benefit in their minds. We can elect legislators, but we can't elect the chief executive. We have nothing, and that's all I want to say. Thank you. Next is Mr. Zhang Gaibing. Good afternoon. The government shouldn't think that with this enhanced retirement protection scheme, we will accept it. We want a non-means-tested universal retirement protection with tripartite contribution. All the calculations have been made. It is proved that it's sustainable till 2046. These calculations are made by civic bodies. We're talking about financing. We should talk about financing, where the money comes from. We have the direction, we have the conclusion, we have public support. How come the government decides not to go ahead with it? We can see that the government's heart is not in it, because where there is a will, there is a way. The chief executive, CY Leung, has set aside $50 billion for retirement protection. We can add another $50 billion to it, then we will have $100 billion as seed money. It will be there will be tripartite contribution to make it sustainable to 2046. However, he refrains from doing that. Instead, he puts in place something with means testing. Do we absolutely need that? So I hope that in the coming 6 months, the chief executive will give some serious thought about this. He has made a promise. He promised us universal retirement protection. It is a good plan for the benefits of Hong Kong people in the long run. This will give good retirement to elderly people. It will also give peace of mind to our youngsters. This will bring society together. This will stop society from being divided. So we need to implement universal retirement protection. Next is Mr. Pang. I believe that a lot of youngsters this morning have talked about this generation war. The government has been listening to public views, and we have organized a youth forum. A lot of students said that they find what the government said unpalatable, because the government said that this is a generation war, which they tried to divide us. But is it really the case? Well, when I was born, I wasn't born with formula milk and nappies. How can the government say something like that? If it is sustainable with tripartite contribution, will there be financial pressure on our youngsters? I think you know full well. Well, the tripartite contribution is very sound. It is better than increasing the OAA and the OALA. Is it the case that the government is trying to evade their responsibility? Well, the OALA is not sustainable. When it comes to that point, then they will have the excuse to cut that. We only need $100 billion as seed money for it to be sustainable, and it will benefit youngsters. We have to repay student debt, student loan. I study in a tertiary education institution. School fees cost me $70,000 a year, and I will be up to my ears in debt when I graduate. And when we graduate, our parents will soon retire. We have to support our parents. With universal retirement protection, then youngsters will directly benefit from it, because we don't have to worry about our work. We don't have to worry about having to save. If the government refuses to implement universal retirement protection, then they in effect penalize people who put money away for savings and youngsters. We have a low social mobility. What can we do in order to save enough for our retirement? Is it just like Mr. Lau, the son of Joseph Lau, saying that we can just cut down on the number of trips we make? I think the government's trying to shift the responsibility onto youngsters, saying that we refuse to support our parents, that this is a generation war. This is just an injustice. I think they're just trying to shift the responsibility onto the public from themselves. Youngsters want to stand out to say that this is not a generation war. We agree that we need the policy to resolve the problems we face. Say, for example, low social mobility, having to support our parents, and also the huge student loan. Mr. Lee, I am 22 years old. I'm from a grassroots family. If I can get a place in university, it will last 4 years. I will have to get a loan from the government. I've already in debt for 100,000 or so, and my family's poor. I looked forward to the report on retirement, universal retirement protection. However, I was disappointed. Most people support this universal retirement protection. However, Mr. Leung Chee Chiang and the government said that, and also the chairman of the Commission on Poverty, Carrie Lam, said that, the conclusion does not have to be supported by consensus from the Commission on Poverty. If that is the case, then they should not have staged this farce. I want to tell you the plight faced by youngsters and how much elderly people need universal retirement protection. If you know someone, a youngster from a poor family, say for example, if you want to get a place, if you have a place in university or a place in associate degree, you finish it, you finish your studies, and if you're lucky, you will have over $10,000, otherwise you earn less. I'll have to give $5,000 for my family, for the student loan. What about insurance policies? What about daily expenditure? I only have about $4,000 or $5,000 left. I can't even think about buying a flat because a flat will easily cost you $3 to $4 million. How many years do you think I'll have to save before I can afford a flat? And I have to support my parents. And when will I be able to put savings away for my retirement? My parents are about to retire, but they are not in a position to retire. The government talks about aging in place, having a good retirement. But I want to ask you, do you know what it's all about, a happy retirement? You don't have to work like government officials, that you don't have to worry about anything. You can travel around the world, you live in a luxurious flat. I want to tell you that elderly citizen in Hong Kong, most of them have to scavenge. Is it happy retirement for them? Don't tell me about OAA and CSSA. It's not a good thing because they will think that it's not dignified. Yeah, elderly people think that they can't live a dignified life. What is dignity? Do you know what that is? Do you know what dignified twilight years is? Is it the case that if you have to go through means testing and then you get some subsidy, that means dignified life? Elderly people would rather work hard and scavenge, and they don't want to be labelled as living on the mercy and the breadcrumbs of the government. Your time's up. Mr. Lam. Thank you. For universal retirement protection, starting from the time when C.Y. Leung was running for the chief executive election, was something that he's been talking about. I heard him say that he would do it. But since he became chief executive in 2013, he asked Professor Nelson Chow to conduct a feasibility study, and then afterwards there was a public consultation. However, the government has a preconceived stance. What kind of mentality is it? I don't understand. And now there is an analysis, and the result is that, according to the consultant, there is a strong support for universal retirement protection with no means testing.
The administration said that it is waiting for the policy address before any definite information can be released. And then this morning it was said that something would be done on CSSA and OH allowance so as to enhance retirement protection for the elderly. We are asked to wait for the policy address. The CE is getting round and round, and he spent 4 years or more, and he's going nowhere. It's a waste of time. I also want to speak on the offsetting of severance pay against MPF. Severance pay should be made by the investor. It's unreasonable to put the burden on MPF. Severance pay is to protect workers from unreasonable dismissal. The public shouldn't be misled and that the severance pay is for retirement. We should distinguish the two. I've not heard anyone from the business community who will say that the arrangement will increase the burden of the employers. The employers should not just put the blame on uncertain future. I've not heard anyone deterred from doing business because of severance pay. And I've never heard an incident in which severance pay leads to the closure of any business. I'm 67 years old. I suffer from back pain. I cannot work. I have contributed to MPF for 14 years. Because of offsetting of severance pay, I got only $50,000, and after 2 years, I spend all the money. MPF cannot help me. All the elderly worked for many decades and contribute to the prosperity of Hong Kong and the development of Hong Kong. Now we've become old, we can no longer work. Why can't the government provide retirement protection? All the elderly worked hard in the past decades, and they have nothing left. The elderly should be cared for in terms of housing, in terms of maintenance, and in terms of our health. Now, elderly have contributed to the community. There should be universal retirement protection. Thank you. Madam Ng, I represent the Civic Party. Now, we should care for our elderly and also other elderly people. We support the Universal Retirement Protection Scheme. There should be no means test. Those aged above 65 should be paid $3,500 out of the Universal Retirement Protection Scheme. There is no need to increase contribution by the working population. Some elderly have worked for many decades. They might have owned their own homes, but they will have to pay for building maintenance. They have to conduct mandatory checks on windows and building, and they will have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars. Well, even if they have about $500,000, they can not feel safe about any good retirement life. I have known many of these elderly people. They have $300,000 of savings, and they may own a flat, but they are still picking cardboards. They are scavengers, and they are very choosy in buying grocery. They really concerned about their expenditure. Now, if there is universal retirement protection, if they are paid $3,500, that will help them a lot. The government just said that this study is not comprehensive enough. That's really unreasonable. The government puts money on white elephants, hundreds of billions of dollars. They're going to build a runway which cannot be used by planes. They're going to build the Hong Kong-Macau-Zhuhai bridge with tens of billions of dollars, and they don't know the traffic volume that will go through. They are just throwing money into the drains. If you recall the incident of the Qin Shi Huang, you know that his dynasty collapsed afterwards. Now, the elderly put in a lot of their efforts and their lives into Hong Kong, yet the government has done nothing to help them. The government just ignored them. The elderly have worked hard for decades, and they are not given adequate retirement protection. The government prefers to throw money down the drain. The government puts money into these white elephant projects. The Qin dynasty collapsed because it squandered people's money, and it could not meet the basic needs of the people. I urge the government to give retirement protection back to all the people, because the money belongs to us. Mr. Lai, this morning in a news report, it was said that the government was going to add one more tier to the scheme, and there would be means tests. I'm against means tests. Now, the funds should be directly funded by government revenue. It is a pay-as-you-go. It should be a pay-as-you-go arrangement. As for the cap of $140,000, what does this amount mean after, say, 10 or 20 years? Will $140,000 be adequate for retirement? Now, in the consultation of health care for the elderly, it is said that the elderly will become richer and richer. It's really, but you can see that many young people have already borrowed heavily when they are studying. Now, young people, when the parents of these young people retire, then these young people will not be able to care for their parents because they are deep in debt. The elderly will have to continue to work. At the end of the day, the elderly and also everybody will not be able to make ends meet. Young people really cannot own their own homes or even raise a family. I'm a young person. I therefore oppose the government's proposal. Universal retirement protection requires the government to give money back to the people. At present, the government is just investing in white elephant projects, useless infrastructure projects. The government does not take humans into account in its future investment. It invests in useless white elephant infrastructural projects. This is bad for the future development of Hong Kong. It's a serious problem. There is a need to introduce universal retirement protection. The government has to give its commitment to the people of Hong Kong and be committed to fund retirement protection for all the people of Hong Kong. First of all, I will not speak on numbers because many academics and I have already spoken on that. I want to speak on those arguments that are against universal retirement protection. Now, some said that there is the OAA, which is non-means tested, $1,970. That is OALA, and the asset cap is $300,000. The government says that some residents have more need than others. But if you just refer to asset limits and income limits, that will be problematic. Say, for example, an elderly has a saving of $1 million. He has already exceeded the limit. But if he is chronically ill, he has cancer, then the medical bill can consume his $1 million very soon. According to the definition of OALA, he has no need for OALA, but in fact, he does have the need. Universal retirement protection is basic. It is a starting point of elderly welfare. And on top of that, there are other needs and also other kinds of welfare. So universal retirement protection is basic. The government says that there is no money for universal retirement protection. According to the proposals of the academics, which is non-means-tested, basing on the data they provide, the scheme is funded by government revenue and also by employers and big businesses. Then the scheme is sustainable. The government claims that the scheme is not sustainable because the government just looks at its own revenue. So some say that if we want to impose a charge or levy on the big businesses, that will undermine competition. But that is not the case. Looking at other countries like Singapore, the profits tax is 0.5% higher than that of Hong Kong, but it is not less competitive. Now they require contribution to provident fund up to 10 or 15%, so the tax rate is higher, much higher than Hong Kong. It's just that the government doesn't want to change its mindset. Mr. Chen, many groups have already said that universal retirement protection is not welfare, it's a matter of rights. The government should not put up a red herring to misdirect people's attention. We want the elderly to live a dignified life, yet the government takes the lead in discriminating against the elderly. Retirement protection is regarded as welfare and handouts. The pro-establishment tries to smear the elderly. The government's proposal is to have a means-tested scheme, but even Mr. Michael Tin says that that is too mean-spirited. Now, some suggested that there should be means-test. Well, if that's the case, you better have means-test for those who are to receive free education. Hong Kong is an advanced society, yet the government is very mean in providing support to the people. According to the World Bank's five-pillar approach, it is said that Hong Kong doesn't have the fourth pillar, which is informal support. And also, if there is no CSSA, we don't have the second pillar. We only have the second pillar. Now, you may receive the OAA or OALA. You just need to you can only rely on about $20,000 per month, and there is no dignity to speak of. Now, we work long hours. We are on the top of the list, and yet our retirement protection is much backward than Taiwan or the PRC. The government spent billions of dollars on the white elephant, the runway, the third runway, and Carrie Lam proposed to spend huge sums on the museum, and the government also caused division between elderly and the future generation and said that it's unfair to ask the general, the younger generation to support to pay for retirement protection of the elderly. That's really disgusting. She caused division among the generation. So we will not be swindled by the government. We have to face up to the problem of aging population. We will not behave like Carrie Lam, who just cares for herself. Now, we will support our elderly, but the government also has the responsibility to take to impose a levy on the rich and the big businesses. Next, Mr. Wong. I believe that many have already spoken on data and the statistics, and I will speak from the perspective of the grassroots. The housewives worked 365 days a year free of charge. They don't even have any savings. Now, before I came, I handled a case, and that was a common case. A woman starts to work in the morning, say at 7, and then she prepares breakfast, and then do some clean-ups, and then send children to school, and then go to buy grocery, and then cook lunch, and then go to school to take back the children, and then make the evening meal, and then she worked a whole day. According to the CNS department survey, the homemakers spend about 5.7 hours on household chores free, and if such contribution is not given any weight, then the person is heartless. Now, they keep on working, and they are not remunerated. When they retire, they can, of course, when they are old, they can no longer work, and the government, the community at large, has nothing to recognize such free labor. Now, we have discussed this retirement protection issue for many years. When I was a student, I participated in the protests and marches, and up till now, after many years, there is no improvement. I think we can make reference to a calculation. Now, the homemakers spend about 5.7 hours on household chores, and if you look at an experienced home helper, home domestic worker, the hourly rate is $105 per hour, then the annual income, the monthly income will be more than $13,000. Now, we need to give recognition to this. If you do not, then this is a kind of exploitation. $18,000 is not a small sum, and in fact, it's more than that. The homemaker is also providing care to other family members, so the contribution is more than $18,000 per month. The government should implement universal retirement protection, otherwise the homemaker's efforts will not be given any recognition. It's just encouraging exploitation. So the government should implement universal retirement protection ASAP.
Mr. Lam Chakay, please. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I'd like to ask Mr. Xu, where is Mr. Matthew Cheng? Because, you know, according to me, the meeting started at 9 a.m. this morning, and it's already now 3 o'clock. He has not made an appearance so far, and I'm not sure whether he will make an appearance in the later session. This is very important, yet today he's absent from the session. I'm not sure whether the chairman has invited him to attend, or is he not coming even though you have invited him. I would like you to tell me where he is today. Well, back to our topic today. The Secretary for Labor and Welfare is not here today, yet it seems that there would be a three-tier system of around $3,000 in the future. I'm not going to go into details. I want to first talk about direction, because Ms. Carrie Lam and Mr. Matthew Cheng emphasized many times that in the policy address there would not only be a solution, there would also be a direction. Well, this direction is very important. Would it be some sort of benefit for some people, or would it be universal protection for all? It seems that he's now moving towards a means-tested direction. He's actually damaging some of the values in Hong Kong. Many people in Hong Kong would try to save up for themselves so that they wouldn't need to rely solely on the government or their families after retirement. But this sort of means-tested system actually encourages people not to save up. Well, you can only get your $3,400 with 140,000 savings. Well, you know, you know that all MPF contributions exceed this amount. So who can get this money? So I think the only way is to use up all your savings. Otherwise, you would never be able to get this subsidy. The government policy can really change the habits of people. So is that the way you want for the future of Hong Kong? We always talk about universal retirement protection, not because for the money. We want to encourage our values, which is to provide for the elderly, which would lead to a more harmonious society. You don't have to use up all your savings in one go. Ms. Choi, thank you. I'm from the Hong Kong Women's Center Association. We attach huge importance to the rights of women, so we do want universal retirement protection. We want it to be non-means tested, and that there must be some sort of system. We do have a lot of our colleagues from Sham Shui Po and other areas, and we have already told you how the women in these areas live, and that there is a huge situation of poverty in women. I want to talk about the research, the report, because the results are very disappointing. The focus groups have collected ideas and views, and said that they have analyzed the views. On April 15th, 2016, we attended one focus group, and 16 people attended. Even though that hour was not very friendly, many people tried to attend, and we did emphasize our wish for universal retirement protection. But then we see from the report analysis that there has not been any collation of views, and that these views have only been lightly brought forward, and there was only one mention of women in the entire report. And so this is very disappointing for women, and we query the reliability of the report. In the questionnaires, you said that 90% people support universal retirement protection, but then the report said that, you know, this could actually been these are actually not as important. I have to tell you that, you know, we have told all our residents living nearby that there would be such a public consultation, and even though some people could not write, they asked us to put in their views, but then their views have not been respected. And within 3 hours, we received 70 written views. And even some residents went out onto the streets to and call upon more people to participate in the consultation. The government's response was that, yes, you know, there were some major organizations bringing forward this survey. I hope that the government will not put these views aside and to look into universal retirement protection for all. Thank you. I'm sorry, I got your name wrong, Mr. Output. Well, Mr. Kwok, you also called me by the wrong surname last time when you were chairman. Oh, I'm really sorry. I really must get my eyes inspected. Mr. Lim Yong K. Thank you, Chairman. I'm a concern group for retirement for women. Well, we have talked to many elderly women, and we do see that many people are concerned with a means-tested system. The government said that there would be a cash subsidy of $3,400, but then you still talk about the means test. You always emphasize on the means test, so even though you try to better the scheme, you are still talking about being means-tested, which is very worrying for elderly women because they do not have enough money. They would have to rely on their old age allowance when they reach the age of 70. And very often, their children can only take care of their own families and do not have extra money for themselves. Therefore, the elderly can only scrimp on what they use at home. Very often, the women will try to seek welfare in Sham Shui Po to try to meet their needs. And that is because our retirement protection cannot give them enough support to ensure that they would be able to live a respected life. On March 3rd of 2014, a report was made public that the aging population will bring forth more deficits. The government should not delay any longer. You have to make sure that the elderly receive enough protection. If the government insists on not following up with such a scheme, then the elderly would have to continue to live on very basic money, and then that would make their lives more difficult. So I do hope that the government will come forth with the universal retirement protection as soon as possible. Thank you, Ms. Chen Wo-Yi. Thank you, Chairman. Ms. Choi Sin-Man and other friends have already mentioned that retirement protection does not include women, and that usually women are not put at the priority list. Very often you see that women are at high risk. The MPF contribution is linked with jobs, and so it would bring along a gender discrimination. The inequality between men and women will lead to huge discrepancies in elderly lives. Right now, there are already 640,000 women doing household chores for free, and most of them are women. The MPF scheme cannot help them at all. As Mr. Lam said previously, each woman has different experiences. They might not have their husbands' financial support nor their children's support. And very often they rely financially on their families. And so their retirement protection will can only be relied on their families. And if their husband and children cannot support themselves, then how can they also support the wife or mother? We see many household assistants not being included in the MPF contribution. And so they cannot be protected after retirement. Therefore, retirees do not have enough money for basic needs. So the MPF scheme actually has given rise to discrepancies between their lives after retirement and their lives before. And it is met very often because of the family status that women do not have enough savings for after retirement. And women on average live longer than men, so you can see that there are more poor women than men. So without a universal retirement protection, it will not be able to help the women because the woman in the family has spent their entire lives looking after their own families. So we hope that after retirement, they would be able to enjoy their lives. With a means-tested system, it would take away their financial support. And we hope that they would not have to rely on their families for financial support after retirement. Mr. Ng Chong Tan, thank you. We see that after Mr. C.Y. Long has announced that he's not going to run for election, you can see that Ms. Carrie Lam is now working very hard to get the spot. No, even though people are against it, she's trying to get her own way with the Forbidden City Museum scheme and the West Kowloon development. We've talked about universal retirement protection for many years, and the majority of the public actually is in support of the retirement plan. I'm sure that you have received the 1,800 completed questionnaires, and even though you have asked Professor Nelson Chow to look into the survey, you still say that you know that there is no need for such a protection plan. Ms. Carrie Lam said that her role will change in 2017. Well, as a resident in Hong Kong, I suggest that Ms. Carrie Lam open up a moving company. I'm sure that this role would be very would be a very good role for her. You have to look into the protection of old people to see whether it would be sustainable for retirees. This is not something that we talk about today. We've talked about this for 20-odd years, so I'm not going to repeat what I've said earlier. I'm sure that you all speak Chinese, you all know Chinese. If you really want to understand, you would understand what is happening so far. So I sincerely call upon all of you here, well, even though there are not too many councillors present, that the government will come up with a protection plan, and I do hope that councillors will filibuster in this council during the budget. And even if you don't filibuster, you must try to vote an objection to the budget. I hope that you will really do something for the elderly. Mr. Chen Chi-Wing. Well, I'm just a public member of Hong Kong. Well, I want to say what I've been seeing so far. What I see right now is a large insurance company's report on MPF. If I remember correctly, MPF scheme started in October 2000. So, you know, it's been 16 years since the commencement of the MPF scheme. Well, I haven't really looked much into the MPF contribution for 16 years because you can only get the money after you turn 60. What I find out finally is that all my investments have gone astray these years. Well, although there's a mention that the management fee will be reduced, I can tell you that for 16 years, some of my investments has only risen 49%, and one has been done better, an increase of 69%. Well, I'm not going for the too aggressive funds. In the 16 years, you know, we have gone through ups and downs, financial crises, and there has been fluctuation in the financial market. I understand that. However, I want to emphasize that it is because of the exorbitant management fees that many of the money has fallen into the fund managers' pockets and not to us. I read a financial magazine saying that someone has done a simulation to find a layman who doesn't know how to invest to use his MPF contribution to buy funds at the end of each month and to buy the tracking fund, and found that actually this layman actually earned more than the really experienced fund managers. Well, as you know, the tracker fund is very conservative. So you can say that this MPF scheme is totally a failure. Because, you know, for a layman who doesn't know how to invest, you know, he earns much more because much of the fees have actually gone to the fund manager's pockets. Well, I work back and forth on the mainland in Hong Kong. Sometimes I do not get my pay at the end of the month. And, you know, sometimes we have to transfer the funds, and you see that ODD is around 7%, so I can only say that all my investments have not been successful. Ms. Yong Chi-wai, thank you, Chairman. I'm a young person in Hong Kong. I hope that you would not once again, you know, say that we're not in support of it. Although I'm young, I do support the retirement protection plan. So 689 must do what he has promised. You spent 500 billion. The government has commissioned Dr. Nelson Chow to do a report, but then, you know, the report was not correct, and Ms. Carrie Lam just went on to say that, you know, that this is not their fault. So you already have a stance. Are you trying to lie to everyone in Hong Kong? We know that you are. These are numbers that you showed today. Actuarists and the public have tried to work out the figures, and they are able to work out the figures that the Universal Retirement Protection Plan will help people save up more. Well, all you officials just send your children abroad for the studies. It's not that you don't have money, you just don't have a conscience. Secondly, even if there is a fiscal crisis, why do you have to cut the protection plan and not cut someone else? Well, the secretary is not present today. Undersecretary, let me ask you, our government spent billions and billions of on white elephant projects. You're just building upon the bones of old people. You spend all these billions of dollars. You're just wasting our money. You're wasting taxpayers' money, sacrificing old people's welfare so that old people cannot enjoy retirement or life after retirement. We need money for welfare. So when the money is going into the white elephant projects, where will the money be for the old people? Why can we not increase the reserves in our treasury? We don't do what other countries are doing. We don't even try to come up with a better tax system, because you have to ensure that the rich people in Hong Kong will continue to be rich. I have to tell you that, you know, welfare and retirement protection is your responsibility. It's not something that you just give out to the poor.
You talk about being patriotic. I tell you that the first virtue in a Chinese society is to be filial. If you are trying your best to be patriotic, don't forget about this virtue in Chinese culture. You are vile. You are scheming. You are cruel. This is how you treat our elderly people. And this is an insult to your motherland. If you love Hong Kong, if you love your motherland, you have to step down. Mr. Wong, all along, for people who have been fighting for universal retirement protection, they have made it very clear that this is not a surface scheme. This is the basic right of Hong Kong people. If you want to do something about poverty, then you should improve CSSA. For a 4P household, it's about $4,000 plus $4,000 for rental. You can't even rent a subdivided flat in Sham Shui Po. And if you are by yourself, and if you make $7,000, you'll make it. You'll find it difficult to live in Hong Kong. It will cost you $40 for lunch and about $70 for dinner in a chain restaurant. For people who are on CSSA, do you know how much they are given? $400 for a month for a student to cover all the meals and entertainment and expenditure related to studying. However, the government wants to dress up the OALA as a retirement protection. We want a universal retirement protection, but you have done nothing. You rely on people like Brother Ming of Sham Shui Po and Benson, who have to rely on themselves to go help street sleepers and those who are poor. And you make it sound like you have done a lot when it comes to poverty alleviation. That is disgraceful. Well, you can only enjoy the $45 if you go to a public hospital, if you make less than a certain amount. And if you want to send your children to a better school, then you will have to spend tens of thousands of dollars, and that is on top of buying some bonds of the school. But you have fully neglected the fact that education and healthcare is the basic right of a citizen. And I want to talk to you about an experience I had. About 80-90% of Hong Kong people want a non-means tested universal fair retirement protection scheme with a standard rate. Do you know why 20% of people opposed to it? Because they thought that we're trying to stir up trouble. Because this is an ideal and feasible scheme. They thought that the government would not easily give it to you, and that's why some people will try to cause trouble. You see how despicable this government is. Policies that harm Hong Kong people, they want them to go ahead at full steam. For those who would benefit Hong Kong people, they drag their feet, they don't want to move, they just want to hide. They hide in their air-conditioned office, or they are just go on holiday on public money. Do you know that you have spent Hong Kong people's money to spend in a hotel when you go on holiday? We would rather spend the money on a dog. There should be no more delay when it comes to universal retirement protection. Mr. Chen, Tan Ji Chong. I want to make it very clear to you that as a teacher, I support the 2046 Universal Retirement Protection, the 2064 Universal Retirement Protection. I know people who are professional, say for example, those in the financial services, radiographers, barristers, landscape planners, actuary, teachers, accountants, professors at universities. They are from the middle class. They fully support a non-means-tested Universal Retirement Protection Scheme. As teachers, we agree that the government should put in place proper infrastructural projects. But I don't mean the Belt and Road Initiative or high-speed railway. As you can see, that these projects proposed by the government are not supported. I don't understand why the government has no empathy at all. The government should put in place resources to implement non-means-tested universal retirement protection scheme as soon as possible so that Hong Kong will become an inclusive and tolerant society. There will be more harmony. And we can see in the consultation process that the government is trying to provoke conflicts, to create conflicts. You see, the people come to public hearings, most of them just want to clarify. We have an aging population. We need stable and we need stable social security protection. Of course, it's someone's entitlement to enjoy a stable retirement protection when they get old. Scavengers want to get retirement protection because this is their basic right. Where is the conscience of the government? Is it something that a responsible government would do? We want a non-means-tested universal retirement protection because it will benefit different sectors in society, as a lot of people have said, and it will give more confidence to people. Everyone will age, including government officials. We are all entitled to a dignified old age. Universal retirement protection is a civic right. That's how we teach students. It is not something that you beg from the government. It's not the mercy of the government. It should not be scrapped from the table of the government. Even a merchant, Mr. Li Ka-shing, can go to a public library to borrow a book. You can't rule him out. Any elderly citizen is entitled to a concessionary fare when it comes to transportation. Why not universal retirement protection? So we ask the government to launch non-means-tested universal retirement protection as soon as possible. Mr. Lo. Well, Mrs. Carrie Lam should come here because she is the chairman of the Commission on Poverty. She should be present to listen to the views of the public. However, in the last subcommittee on the retirement protection, she was not here. She was not here to explain about the report, even though there were loads of doubts about the suspected intervention of the consultation report. She was not there last time. She's not there. She's not here this time. It's not because she's not in Hong Kong. She will come to Legco to explain about the Imperial Palace Museum in West Kowloon. You can see what's important to her because she attaches a lot of importance of something that sucks up to those in power, and people's livelihood is unimportant to her. If you are doubted because you have suspected to have intervened in the consultation report, then you have to come to explain to the media and to the public, because out of the 18,000 submissions received, 16,000 of them are of the same template. These all support universal retirement protection. They think that using a quantitative approach will create bias. If you think that is the case, how do you explain that in the past decade, many different political parties, education institutions, Well, whether it is pro-government groups or pan-democrat groups, all these surveys and opinion polls show that over 60% of the respondents support a non-means-tested universal retirement protection. And these studies show that over 80% of the respondents support universal retirement protection. If you think that the 16,000 submission is biased, then how do you explain that in the past a decade of all the opinion polls and studies done by different political parties and education institutions, most of the people support universal retirement protection? How do you explain that? So Carrie Lam should come to explain to us. Apart from coming to explain, she should come to listen to the views of the public as to why they support universal retirement protection, because this will benefit everyone, no matter which sector you are from in society. Say, for example, housewives. They work, but it's not gainful employment. They don't benefit, they don't get protection from MPF. Well, that person has left. That person talked about when he or she retires, she will only get about $50,000 from MPF and it's not enough. If you say that MPF is sufficient to pay for your retirement, that is wrong. And I also want to say that if universal retirement protection is not in the policy address, then those who said that they support universal retirement protection should oppose to the policy address, including FTU. I've already answered this morning. I'm not going to do so now. Next, Mr. Wong. But someone reminded me that when I come here, I have to say to government officials about this. If they bury their conscience, if they make people suffer, there will be comeuppance. And as you know, that there has been some examples. How come the cart is put before the horse for this government? Well, when there is traffic congestion, instead of building roads, they want to impose tax. And if there is too much rubbish, they want to charge for municipal waste. We ask you to do more about recycling and waste management. You refrain from doing so, and you are allowed waste to be imported into Hong Kong, and you also allow public hospital charges to be increased. You force elderly people to stay at home until they're critically ill. For those who have a special privilege, if you increase the fee to $1,000, they will still come to you, but not for poor people. The government refused to help those who are in need. So unless you are the privileged, say for example you are a civil servant, you are bureau secretary, you enjoy over $100,000 or $200,000 wage, then you enjoy all the benefits. You have a pension, you have a retirement benefits, but if you're not government official, then you don't have anything. And they said that, they cited an example saying that if Li Ka-shing so rich, why is he entitled retirement protection? But he pays a lot of tax. Well, Western people talk about give and take. Do not mislead youngsters saying that the government will go bankrupt. It's a lie. If the government goes bankrupt, it's because they have done something wrong. They have allowed people to come to speculate on in our property market and securities market. And you should help elderly people. We're only talking about $200 or so. Well, if you refuse to help young people will suffer in the end. You talk about how many elderly people there is going to be. I suggest that you should not talk about aging in place. You should just simply put them in the grave. You say you have no money. It doesn't really matter, because Jockey Club is generous enough to give you a lot of money to build a museum. Poverty alleviation is different from retirement protection. Someone told me that, a scavenger told me that if he wants to get $1,000 as an OH allowance, people will come to look through his property, look through his finances, and it's not very dignifying. You should ask Chiu Chau people to help you because they're most generous. Your time is up. Next, Mr. Cole. We are a group of youngsters of our Christian group. We feel ashamed because we are ashamed because of some government officials who claim themselves to be Christians. Carrie Lam is a Christian, is a Catholic who will distort facts. There has been some report saying that the CS4A might have intervened in the result of the consultation in the consultant's report. If that is the case, then CS4A, Mrs. Carrie Lam, has distorted public sentiment. She knew fully well that there is general support for the universal retirement protection and it will be sustainable after 2064. However, she lied. Mrs. Carrie Lam claims to be a Catholic. I wonder whether she will feel guilty about this. And that the same applies to the Secretary for Labour and Welfare as well. Carrie Lam might have lied to cover another crime or sin. It's theft, but it's not something that you can report to the police. What she has stolen is the contributions made by elderly people who have contributed to Hong Kong when they are young. She has stolen the right to a happy retirement from these elderly people. We have the Ten Commandments. Catholics should not steal. Government officials, including the undersecretary, you live in a luxurious flat, work in an air-conditioned office, you send your children overseas to study, you enjoy a very good salary. It's all given to you by Hong Kong people. However, you refuse elderly people to when they ask for $3,000 for a dignified retirement life. If it's not theft, what is it? In Jacobs, it says that if you see someone who is not close, instead of giving them clothes, instead of giving them something to eat, then and you just say that, I wish you a very safe journey. That is not enough because you have not done anything to help that person. Jacob said that some people, you should not just talk, you should act as well. And old people should be given a proper place to age in peace. But where are they supposed to go? You don't see a lot of people scavenging and sleeping in streets. Well, Carrie Lam said there is a place in heaven for her. I don't know whether that is true. I hope that there should be a non-means test, universal retirement protection as soon as possible because that's the least you can do and that's your duty. Good afternoon, everyone. We, the elderly, our council asked for universal retirement protection because retirement protection is a basic right. It's not charity. It's an elderly policy. It's social benefit. Retirement protection will also help youngsters. It will give them a chance to make contribution to society. And the government should enable elderly people to lead a dignified life after retirement. They should be given protection without means testing. And the government should take the lead to show respect towards our elderly citizen because this is a way to promote harmony in society. This is also an example to youngsters. Universal retirement protection will give peace of mind to elderly people so that they will be happy to spend and it will help our economy. Universal retirement protection will also alleviate the financial burden on children. on your children. And universal retirement protection is social justice. You take care of your young and your old. This will promote harmony. Some people ask how come the rich can benefit if there is universal retirement protection. I want to ask a question too.
Even Li Ka-shing does receive OH allowance, he has paid tax more than many other people. And some ask why one has to support the parents of other people. I want to ask why we upset the tradition of not just caring for your own parents, but also care for the elderly of other families. It means this, a retirement protection scheme will not care for elderly homemakers. There's a need to provide universal retirement protection. We support the sustainable retirement protection scheme proposed by the academics. It can be sustainable until 2064. The government should continue to improve welfare for the elderly and promote social harmony. Next, the government should answer the following questions. With regard to the consultancy report, has the government asked the consultants to change the content of the report? And if there was, then what has been changed? And why the government sidestepped the Commission on Poverty and ignore the proposal by the consultants? Why the government's dodging the issue? Why the government does not respond to public opinion? If public opinion is not the main consideration, what's the point of public consultation? The government also said that public consultation is to let people analyze the issue and have a deeper understanding of the issues, but it's a waste of public funds if it's just for public education. The academics have proposed a comprehensive funding arrangement for universal retirement protection. The government refuses to discuss that. The government just hides the proposals from the public. The recommendations made by the academics are sustainable. I want to ask Carrie Lam and also the government, what about the administration costs for means tests and how much people have to pay for the means tests and for the administrative costs because of means tests? We need to work for the caring of the elderly and also the caring of the future generations. The government should include reports, news reports into parents' guide requirement, because the government's statements, the statements made by officials are misleading the people and cause greater harm than other materials. If the government continues to go against public opinion, the government is just going against the people. Carrie Lam will only cause the younger generation and the older generation to work together and protest against the government, and they will support the Legislative Council in voting against the government budget. You will see young people and also elderly people working together. Those who are against universal retirement protection will have to face the outcome of the ballot box. Now, will they vote for you if you oppose universal retirement protection? Mr. Chen Kam-chung. Thank you, Chairman. The government concludes public funds should be used cost effectively. The government sitting on hundreds of billions of reserves. The government should spend the money on people, on caring for the people, yet the government ignores public opinion. Now let's look at the sums. The financial secretary, over 9.5 years, has wrongly estimated the surpluses. He said that there would be deficits, but in fact, every year after year, there was a deficit. The government selectively exaggerated public expenditure and tried to cheat. Now, there are 6 white elephant projects, the Hong Kong-Macau-Zhuhai Bridge, the WKCD, the Sha Tin Central Line, Lin Tong Heng Yun Wai Border Crossing, the third runway. Cost overruns reach more than $120 billion. Cost effectiveness of these projects are really questionable. Yes, the government is dodging the issue. As for universal retirement protection, according to the academics, additional expenditure for the government is only about $100 billion. And it's only the $100 billion are just seed money. And the fund is also supported by contributions of the working class and also contribution from the employers. The government is hiding information from us. The government has just exaggerated the financial costs of universal retirement protection. The government just says that the universal retirement protection scheme is not sustainable. This is lying. Many researchers in overseas countries have shown that a good universal retirement protection scheme is a kind of social investment. It will lead to economic benefits. In 2013, there was a report in the United States which said that every $1 of retirement fund will produce $2 in GDP. 57 million people in the U.S. received retirement protection, and the GDP created was more than $1,400 million GDP, and it also provides tax revenue for the government. Now, if universal retirement protection is implemented in Hong Kong, then only there will be about $30 or $40 billion, which will be contributing to our economy. Your time is up. Next, Madam Low. Well, I'm an ordinary elderly. I think that universal retirement protection should be implemented. Well, we raise our family. We just want to have peaceful retirement. We have some savings so that we can have a good retirement life. But prices are rising, and it's really hard for us to have a good retirement. Now, there is health care provided by the government, but we still want to keep some pocket money so that we can have we can live a stable life. We don't want to be rich. We just hope that we can be cared for. The elderly just want to be cared for, and they don't need to worry about their living. We are against means tests. Elderly people have savings because they want to support themselves. They of course can ask for money from their parents, from their children, but their children also need to raise their families. It's not true that the younger generation doesn't want to care for the older generation. There's a need to implement universal retirement protection. There should be no dragging of feet on the part of the government. The elderly people are really old and their days are numbered, so to speak. We don't want to worry about our life. The government keeps on consulting, keeps on conducting studies. It's a waste of public funds. Why don't you spend the money on helping the elderly to meet the urgent needs of the elderly? That's more realistic. Before C.Y. Leung took office, he made promises to elderly people. He said that he would help the elderly, help the poor. But what has he done? He should not default. I don't know whether he will be the CEO of the next term. I'm just an ordinary elderly. Many elderly are worried about their lives. Their children have their families. It's not that they don't want to support their parents, but cost of living is too high. And after we have spend all our savings, how can we live on? Mr. Zhang, as for the benefits of universal retirement protection, many have spoken on that, and I support that. I think the problem is on the part of the government. The problem is the CE. Does the CE care about it? Now C.Y. Leung has defaulted. The government is not doing its part. Now, we have been reunited with the mainland for nearly 20 years, and yet there is no possibility of having universal retirement protection. The elderly is not cared for. I'm poor, and I really, how my life will end. I'm worrying about my living. Why can't there be universal retirement protection? I really don't know whether the government cares about cares for the people, or whether the officials just care about themselves. The government is useless. I want to ask the officials, you get your salaries, you get your perks. What have you done for the people? Do you have a conscience? Have you given a fair deal to the people of Hong Kong? The answer is no. The officials should come out and speak to us. The government, the officials are just sitting on their hands. They're doing nothing. So everybody is worried, and there is division in the community. The community is divided. In the past 20 years, we can see how Hong Kong has become. The people just fight. And elderly people are not cared for. Is Hong Kong poor? They've got taxpayers' money. And what? How do they spend the taxpayers' money? Many have already pointed out the problems. I don't need to repeat them. I really urge the government to seriously consider universal retirement protection. Do something good for the people. I just hope that there can be universal retirement protection so that we can have a peaceful life of retirement. Well, in implementing, in deciding on a social policy, and there's a need to consider the circumstances of the community. Are we a world-class city or are we a poor community? The policymakers say that we don't have the means to implement universal retirement protection. The government ignores public opinion. The government suppresses public opinion. Is it wise to do so? You may win, apparently, and you have a greater reserve. You have more money in public coffers, but you don't have credibility. You cannot win the heart of the people. We've heard those official leases. We have heard such cliches. We've got used to such cliches. Should we just give up? It's wrong to give up. How many decades can we wait? Now, we used to compare with ourselves to Singapore, but many, many years ago, Singapore has already implemented a central provident fund. We spent decades and decades, we just dragging our feet, and then after a few more decades, there is no future. Now, in March 2015, the future fund is wrong again, and how many and what kind of future do we have now? After 2 years, we have about 2,000 billion dollars. Mr. Lam at that time said that the reserves were adequate for 9 financial crises. Now we have huge reserves. Why couldn't we invest in our society? How long should the government delay? Is means test the best? And don't you know there's a cost to conducting means test? Apart from the administrative cost, there is time and there is social cost, and also the cost of family relationship, and also the cost between the social cost of division among different social groups. Are these not costs? Now, the policymakers claim to be wise. Then can they be really wise so that they can invest in this good social infrastructure? I'm Kun Kwan from the Confederation of Trade Unions. We are not asking for a luxurious retirement protection scheme. It's just about $100 per day for an elderly. And the government says that it cannot do this, it is not financially sustainable. It's really basic and the amount is small. If the government is not able to do it, then the government should step down. The officials should step down. What's the use of having such officials? They should not resort to the excuse of financial sustainability. If you don't do it, if you can't do it, then you better step down. There were many rounds of consultation. It's a political issue. It's really clear. There is a financial arrangement, and the businesses will have to pay more taxes. The government will have to earmark a part of reserves for that. The officials only take into account the interests of the rich and famous and powerful. It's a political issue. It's not. It's a matter of will, rather. Retirement protection is an issue of the elderly and of the young people. It's also an issue of the working class. It's about the wealth of the people. Now, the working class have been exploited. 0.4, you don't know what it is. According to this CNS department, in 2016, in the first quarter, the real wage increase is 0.4%. Apparently, we receive a pay increase, but after deducting inflation in the first quarter, the actual wage increase, the real wage increase is only 0.4%. The officials might not have heard about it because they didn't care.
0.4%, you're talking about breadcrumbs. 0.4% increase will need to pay, you know, for electricity, utilities, for our children's education. These expenses will not wait for our wage to increase. We'll ask whether the rate will increase the rent or whether the flat owners will increase rent. They don't care. Our wage has only increased by 0.4%, yet we still have to pay all these expenses and you still want to conduct a means test. Is that the way you want to go? You know, people will never be able to get the subsidy with a means test. Are you trying to be funny? All workers or air employees should go out onto the streets. Do not believe this government. Occupy Central was not done only by young people. There were also many employees who came out to take the streets then. Well, all the deputations have spoken. How many members here would like to speak? Mr. Leung Kwok Kong, this will be the second round, so you'll get 2 minutes. And Ms. Lau Siu Lai, your first round, you'll get 3 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I think I did my fair speech on universal retirement protection in deputations meetings and in other meetings. I think I have talked about every single point there is to be. What more is there to say? What we lack here is the responsibility of the government. So originally, I didn't plan to speak in this session. But now, I speak up not to try to, you know, put a video clip online. But if you really listen to these sessions, you would be very touched. I see young people coming out. I asked, you know, some young people in my old school, they're still very young, asked about what they think about retirement protection. They said, oh, you know, it's so far away. But now we see young people here supporting universal retirement protection because they see the elderly living very harsh lives. Well, you might think that, you know, as Mr. Wong just now being very humorous, because you say that instead of enjoying elderly life, they're actually waiting, you know, to die peacefully. I distributed wool scarves and blankets to the elderly during Christmas break. They are not the ones who come up here, but some told me that, you know, they have 5 children, but even though they have 5 children, they all have their own problems, their own families, no one can support them. And they told me that they hope for suicide, but they could not do so because they still have a child who is mentally disabled. And then there was another woman who was dressed quite elegantly. She told me, no, I have one son. I do not want my son to support me, but I do not have savings. Because I do have a little bit of savings, I do have to pay my own way for medical expenses and for other things. And she suffers from eczema, but she didn't want to go to the doctor because she was afraid that she will not have enough money for her life in the future. When you all spoke up, you know, I thought about this lady. So I want to tell you that, you know, the means test is really unfair for those who have a bit of savings, because you are really making the elderly lead very harsh lives, because they do have to pay their own way if they do have some savings. Mr. Eddie Chu, thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank all of you for coming here to speak. I heard Mr. Luk Zong Hong earlier in the previous session talked about his views. Even though we are of different parties, we are all concerned with the elderly in Hong Kong. We want all people in Hong Kong to live dignified lives. Therefore, we should work united in the Universal Retirement Protection Plan. Hence, I do not want our different political parties to argue with each other and try to point the finger at each other, because at this time, I think we should, you know, work together for the betterment of Hong Kong. Now, this is a very crucial point. Mr. CY Leung is not seeking for re-election, and the incoming CE, even though we don't know who that would be yet, all those running for election, I am sure, want the support of the people of Hong Kong. And therefore, it is a very good time to talk about it. I'm not trying to request the government to do something. I think I have said this to Mr. Matthew Cheung before. I came up with a very simple mathematics formula. We have 34 members in LegCo who is in support of universal retirement protection without means test. And these 34 members can, before the policy address and before the budget, work together to ensure that the government will commit to this before the end of this tenure. I'm working with the unions also to try to succeed. Well, the chairman talked about worrying about the financial cliff or the fiscal cliff. So, well, we don't want this either. So can we all work together to try to really do something for the people of Hong Kong during this very crucial period to ensure that everyone will be able to enjoy retirement protection? I hope that those from the union will be able to talk to us after the meeting. Well, I can give you a simple response. Well, we support a retirement plan, but we cannot really support your particular scheme. So I'm sorry. I'm sorry to say that, Mr. Leung Kwok Kong, Chairman. Well, Ms. Carrie Lam is now busy with the Palace Museum. I am not going to reprimand her today. I want to share with you some words spoken by poets before. Mr. Wong Zhouzak wrote a poem when he lost his job, and he talked about his feelings. on how he felt for his mother after losing a job. His mother was already very old and he didn't have a job, so both of them hugged each other and cried. And he felt that he was very apologetic towards his mother, because even though he was present, he is her son, he could not do anything to support his mother. So even though he was there, he could not do his duty as his son to look after his mother. Well, the government has so much money. You attach such importance to Chinese values. So you really should look into filial piety. There's also another poem that can describe Miss Carrie Lam. She's only looking into the Palace Museum now. She's a person who headed the consultation, but now she's into another project, into Palace Museum. So what can she do about the retirement protection plan? Your time is up, Mr. Lan Kok Kong. Some of the views are similar with the previous sessions, but here we can see that for women who worked in the house or who were homemakers, they did not have any MPF scheme. So they would have no retirement protection at all. And there was also mention of the huge responsibility young people have nowadays. They want to be responsible, yet they see that the government also needs to put in a helping hand to alleviate the burden. I'm now going to give the floor to the Under Secretary, and this session will end at 4:30. Thank you, Chairman, and a big thank you to all your views. Mr. Lau asked me where Mr. Matthew Cheung is. Well, this question was asked in the previous sessions as well. I'd like to clarify that if you know Mr. Matthew Cheung, Mr. Cheung is very willing to meet with the deputations. He has participated in many hearings and also many focus groups. He did attend many of the meetings previously, but he already has another previous engagement before he heard of this hearing. He is very willing to attend the next one if time permits. So that's the first response I'd like to make. Secondly, we do acknowledge the hard work contributed by the elderly to society, and we do want them to enjoy good lives after retirement. The government has, for the first time, encouraged the whole of Hong Kong to talk about the retirement protection plan. We do want to come up with a good protection plan. However, it is a very complicated problem. We are willing to face these challenges. In the upcoming policy address, the chief executive will give a response on the retirement protection plan. Many people has discussed whether we should go for the regardless of rich or poor principle or those with financial needs principle. However, if you look at the reports, you would see that for each pillar, whether it be MPF contribution or government welfare or personal savings, we do want to come up with a comprehensive plan. We have highlighted some groups such as women in the reports because those people have not been fully included in the report. And we are going to come up with a comprehensive report in the policy address, including government commitment. Someone mentioned the offsetting issue and the MPF contribution scheme. Well, we understand that there are many arguments about the current MPF scheme and the offsetting scheme, and we understand it. We are trying to come up with better recommendations to try to come up with a better severance pay plan. We have heard many views, and we understand that you all have demands for universal retirement protection, but we do need to consider our finances and to strike a balance between support and welfare. And many of you are also concerned with medical and housing. Therefore, we really need to find a balance. If all public money is put into the regardless of rich or poor principle, then it would slow down improvements in other areas. And that is a reason why we really need to find a good balance. I know that no matter which principle we go for, we will take care of elderly needs. The CE will make public the plans very soon. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank all deputations for attending our meeting today. Yes, Mr. Cheng. We request 100 billion for the universal retirement protection. Well, I just want to clarify it. Don't try to mislead the public. We're talking about a tripartite contribution, but you seem to say that the government is using more money for universal retirement protection. So I will leave this for the professor who is attending in the fourth session to clarify you on this. But I see from the news that Mr. Matthew Cheng is actually not very busy. He's actually at a ribbon cutting ceremony. Oh, so why is he not free to listen to our views? Well, you talk about a discussion and consultation. Well, there's already been a six-month consultation, but you have never responded to it. You understand the needs of the public, and the expert report is also very clear, but you already have your pre-planned plan. And now you talk about a 3,400 cash subsidy. You're just wasting your time, and you wasted all the time and effort of the different groups and members who are trying to help the elderly. I just want to try to be fair. We do not accept what you have said. Please be quiet. Well, your needs have already been heard, and we're going to conclude this session. Can I just supplement One sentence. Well, I talked about MPF just now. I just want to tell the Undersecretary that the MPF scheme should be modified not to become a MPF, that it should be flexible, and that maybe you will be able to take back half of your contributions after working for a certain period of years. Because, you know, many of the SMEs need money before the new year. We do have to spend a lot of money. We do have a lot of expenses. Well, thank you for your views. We are going to commence again in 5 minutes. Thank you.